Yes, good. Yesterday I gave all the philosophical arguments of the motivation of why I'm doing this kind of work. So today, apart from saying that I'm, of course, thankful to have been invited here, and I'm happy to be again in Vienna discussing these very basic issues. But I'll jump in the deep right away, because I want to use as much of my time as I can to show you now a little bit more of the technical details behind the general philosophical observations. And so what I want to do is explain, well, these are the three approaches one can have in quantum mechanics, and so this was the introduction. We can explain either quantum mechanics as a deeper, as an approximation to something else. I won't follow that route. I don't think quantum mechanics is approximate. I think it is exactly true. There's no need to have any extra ingredient to cause decoherence and things like this and measurement. It all goes automatically as far as I'm concerned. The question then is how to explain QM as an explanation of reality, of physical reality, and that is very useful, but not enough. I am trying to investigate why is this world quantum mechanical, and can it be that an underlying theory, a so-called theory of everything, is more basic, more down to earth in a way. It just explains how bits and bytes of information are being processed in our universe. And to handle the statistics, you need tools, mathematical tools. And I like to view quantum mechanics as just a mathematical tool to handle probabilities. And what that means, I'll try to explain in my, this works, in this talk. So first of all, I want to show to you three models which I find extremely interesting, even though they are conceptually extremely simple. Just because they are simple, there's no mathematical mystery of any sort here. There's no question about how to solve things, no question about what mathematical equations to handle. The first example I like to consider for a moment is just the harmonic oscillator, the standard quantum harmonic oscillator. I claim that this oscillator actually is totally equivalent or dual to another model, which is completely classical. A classical object, a particle moving on a circle. Actually, that's just symbolic for any physical process that is periodic in time. So think of an idealized model of a part of the universe. Think of a single atom or a molecule or a planet, which shows periodic motion. And that's all there is, something that repeats itself after a certain amount of time. My claim is that what we call a quantum harmonic oscillator and a classical periodic system, they are dual to each other. They can be mapped onto each other. Anyway, I'll try to explain. Second example will be a chiral fermion. Fermions seem to be the ultimate of quantum mechanical objects, yet also fermions can be mapped onto things which are completely classical. I'll try to explain that. And the example I'm very proud of, although it's not complete and mathematically more delicate, is superstring theory. I'll spend a few words on that. Now, I'm going up pretty fast, because yesterday we had all the time in the world to go into philosophy. Now I just go into the technical details. So think of a harmonic oscillator. And the picture on the left, this picture here is my view of a harmonic oscillator. It's a quadratic potential, a perfect harmonic potential, with energy levels which are equally spaced, beginning with 1/2 h by omega, and then up it goes. If you count correctly, I think I have 9 lines here. So I took the first 9 levels, but I can take the first 900,000 levels. The argument goes the same way. Those system, if I take just the first 9 levels, and I say, well, I don't expect this harmonic oscillator to go beyond that excited state, then this is equivalent to a model where those 9 states are put on a circle, but after making a discrete Fourier transformation. That's a very simple, well-known thing you can do in vector spaces. If you have a 9-dimensional vector space, you can just Fourier transform those states and get 9 other states just a basis transformation, if you will. In terms of these nine other states, you have that the time evolution is not just that these are eigenstates of Hamiltonian, but these are not eigenstates of Hamiltonian. If you go 1/9th of the period of the oscillator, you jump from one state to the next. So this is, these states are just running around and around and around in a, again, in Hilbert space, if you want, but you only look at discrete time steps. At discrete time steps, this state exactly evolves into that one evolves into that, and so on. So in discrete time steps, this is just a clock. I call it a cogwheel. So it's a cogwheel, it's a clock, it just ticks from one state to the next, and this is my way of looking at a classical system. So basically, my claim is after this transformation Hilbert space, the harmonic oscillator becomes classical. Classical means that all I have is these points. I just have a system which can be in 9 different states. State is now a big word for something, just like the dice. If I throw dice, the die can be in 6 states, which depend on which number is up. A coin can be in 2 states, which depends on which of the side of the coin is up. And that's all there is about it. And this thing just evolves from one state to the next in a periodic motion. So this is why I call this thing classical, because there's no interference anymore. Once you have this thing, you can think of it as a classical model of anything rotating, like a planet or an atom or whatever. And I'm only looking at these 9 states. Of course, I can take much more than 9 states. I can take 9 million states. And then these are 9 million points on the circle. So then you get the continuum limit. And in the continuum limit, you just have an angle phi, which just rotates around and around and around. And that's the classical model. It can't be any simpler than that. There, well, this, so this is the sense in which I consider the quantum harmonic oscillator dual or equivalent to a classical periodic system. The dual transformation is nothing but a vector rotation, a basis rotation in Hilbert space. So Hilbert space ends right here. Once you have this classical system, you can discard of Hilbert space and say, I'm only looking at the point going around. And that will be characteristic for all models I'm considering, that once I have it in this form, I can throw away Hilbert space. It's no longer needed to describe what happens here. And so in this sense, harmonic oscillator is equivalent to the classical model. And now I'm asking, are there any other examples? So next example, oh, by the way, I haven't mentioned yet, the mathematics of this mapping is not quite as simple as you might think. And the reason is that the mapping between the states phi of the periodic thing and the states x of the harmonic oscillator, that mapping is rather contrived now. Because it looks so simple, just Fourier transform those 9 states, or those 9 million states, and it can take the continuum limit of that. But the transformation turns out with this expression. Remember, the harmonic oscillator has Hermite functions as its solutions, and there's a normalized with a square root of n factorial downstairs, and then you have to take those states and transform them, and you get the phi states. Well, this is the mathematical expression you end up with. What makes this mathematically delicate is the square root in here. The square root of n factorial. That makes it difficult to do the sum explicitly, but not impossible. But it's just a mathematical, rather strange function. It looks like this. And what you see here is vertically is the angle phi, horizontally the position x of the harmonic oscillator. I could take p as well. It looks very much the same. And you see that here at these values of phi, x is positive. At these values of phi, x is negative, but otherwise it's a complicated interference pattern that you see here. Not very surprising once you realize it is. But this you can calculate. But if you, sorry, how do I go back? Yeah. If you go, if you go through the mathematics, you find it's rather complicated to calculate. And you have to make approximations, but it is straightforward mathematics. Nothing mysterious about it. So my next thing then, so that's harmonic oscillator. By the way, if you have questions about this, then please interrupt, because I could add some. So this was the first simple example. My next example, which is a little bit more delicate and interesting also, is massless chiral fermions. Now, the nice thing about this is, again, there are many examples of massless fermions in nature, or nearly massless fermions. Think of neutrinos. Neutrinos are very light. In many approximations, they can be considered as massless. And in many approximations, they can be considered as non-interacting. So what I'm looking here at is a non-interacting chiral fermion. A chiral fermion only has two rather than four spin components. And the Dirac Hamiltonian then boils down to this. H is just the Pauli matrix is dotted into P. The Pauli matrices tell you that the thing may flip its spin. P is its momentum. This is the first quantized theory. So you can later decide to second quantize it and have an indefinite number of chiral fermions. That is a sophistication for later. Let's first consider the first quantized fermion. It's just this Hamiltonian. Now, this Hamiltonian has some nice features to it, and that is that you can consider a set of variables which is very carefully chosen. I very carefully chose the momentum, but modulo its length. So I divide out the length of the momentum, I just take the orientation of the momentum, except I'll do something with the sign. I'll choose either plus or minus. But this is basically the orientation of the momentum, and the plus or minus have to be looked at a little more carefully later. Then there's an operator S, which is the spin in the direction of its momentum. P hat is a unit vector only with the orientation of the momentum. And so this S, again, has eigenvalues plus or minus 1, spin in direction of motion. And that's typically what you look at if you have a chiral neutrino. And then this R here is the coordinate, the component of the coordinate in the direction of its momentum. Now, coordinate and momentum do not commute, so you have to symmetrize this. And then R is a real number operator that looks at position in the direction of momentum. Now, I chose these three variables. First of all, you can convince yourself that when you have these three variables, you can completely specify a basis of Hilbert space, if you will. And so they are complete. They describe the neutrino space perfectly. And secondly, they all commute. Now, that is slightly less obvious, but you can check that. It's a few lines of calculation to find that indeed all these things commute. And the equation of motion is now this. Well, you work out the equations of motion from this Hamiltonian. Anybody with any experience in quantum mechanics can do that immediately on the back of an envelope. What are the equations of motion generated by this Hamiltonian? It's a very simple Hamiltonian, very simple equations of motion. And they come out by just commuting the Hamiltonian with these operators. And here you can find at the right-hand side, and I won't trouble you with going through the formulas. You can check them for yourself if you want. But you'll find that P hat doesn't change at all. Of course, the Hamiltonian commutes with P hat. S also doesn't change, slightly less trivial, but S is spin in the direction of motion. That commutes to this Hamiltonian because that is just the same Hamiltonian divided by P absolute, which also commutes with the Hamiltonian. So yes, S is also conserved. R is not conserved. The dt of R can also be computed, and you find that to be S. So either this R increases with the speed of light or it negative, it decreases the speed of light, depending on the sign of S. Now, what's nice about this is that all these things commute. This is a completely commuting system, just like this periodic particle on the circle where everything commutes, it commutes forever. You don't need any Hilbert space for these equations. Throw away Hilbert space. And then you find that this neutrino is a system where you could throw away Hilbert space. Now, for a long time, this was the end of the argument. So these chiral neutrinos in this special basis, they certainly behave as deterministic objects. And I like that. It looks like maybe nature itself is also something like this, that we are sitting in the wrong basis. Normally, when you consider neutrinos, you're not looking at these states. You're looking at X or P or all three components of the spin, and then nothing commutes, and then it's a quantum object. But maybe we think our world is quantum mechanical because we are sitting in the wrong basis. Once you choose this very, very special basis, at least neutrinos behave then classically. Of course, I'm talking about non-interacting neutrinos. I'm talking about strictly massless neutrinos. Yes, if you have mass, if you have interaction, it doesn't go anymore. So then you have to think again what to do. But maybe this is the beginning of a larger set of models where actually you can discard Hubble space. But it's not the end of the story. Actually, the argument is quite a bit more complicated. Because now, suppose I work in the other direction. I start with the sheet, which oriented, and the orientation of the sheet is a vector which fits on the unit sphere. And then there's a variable s, which can be in this direction. The sheet moves in the orthogonal direction, that direction, or it moves in that direction, always with the speed of light. So this is the interesting quote-unquote interpretation of a chiral neutrino. A chiral neutrino is a sheet moving at the speed of light in this direction or in that direction. Why a sheet? Well, I only specify the position, orthogonal to the sheet. So I only specify this r, but I didn't specify the coordinate in that orthogonal direction. So there is no coordinate in that orthogonal direction. So the neutrino is the entire sheet, which runs all the way from infinity to infinity. But the only variable there is r here. So physically speaking, this is strange, but yes, this is what I expect of nature. We should be prepared to expect very strange models of nature if all our quantum mysteries that we have encountered today will find natural solutions. Now, it turns out that if you start with a sheet and you then want to reconstruct from there the conventional operators for neutrinos, it's not quite that simple. Because now, if I know where the sheet is, what are the other components of the position of the neutrino? How do I define those operators? I asked myself that question, and I solved it, but I needed to do lots of calculations, and it wasn't that easy at all. For instance, I need on the sheet two coordinates, phi and theta, which are the other, once you have a point on the sphere, you want to have the local r and theta, phi and theta coordinates as well. You need the phi and theta on the sheet because you need to identify the rotation on the sheet, and that is something subtle. After all, the neutrino has spin. So it's a chiral thing. There's something non-trivial about its thing spinning. Now you don't recognize any spin on the sheet. Apart from one little thing, if I rotate the sheet 180 degrees, s goes into minus s. That's just like the z component of the spin of an object. If you rotate 180 degrees, the spin flips sign. So yes, there's some, but that's only spin in the direction of motion, whereas what it really has to do with rotation is somewhat obscure. And actually, at first you think, well, forget it. I'm not interested in that question. I'm just interested in a mathematical transformation. But then you hit upon a problem, and this is the problem, that you need to understand how the sheet rotates in its own plane, so to speak. And then you get, well, these are the equations. From there, you want to make the mapping from the sheet variables, which are Q, or I should have called it P hat, sorry. I call it Q here. Q hat is the coordinate on the unit sphere. It's a vector of length one. PR is the one component of the momentum in the direction of r. Well, that's actually PR is already an operator. It's the displacement operator of the r variable. But you can look at those states. Well, that's just canonical states associated to the r coordinate. And then, of course, s, which is that spin. And I want to map, and this is the first expression you can find, the momentum of the fermion must be q hat times pr. This is a solution of the chiral field equation, so this is a spinner, and pr is just a normalization factor that you need in front in order to normalize the states properly. This is what you really want. From here you go to this line, you go to the r coordinate itself. So these are the two sheet variables, q hat, r, and s. These are the three commuting variables, and these are, well, the x of the neutrino and alpha, which are the three spin components of the neutrino. Alpha is one and two, there's two spin components of the neutrino. And so these are the neutrino states, and these are the sheet states. And this is what you get by just Fourier transforming the expression above. Because of the strange but necessary normalization factor PR, you don't get the delta function, but the derivative of the delta function here. The first surprise that things are not quite as simple as you might thought. It's a derivative of the delta function. And then I wanted to find all the, once I have the sheet variables, I want to have the operators x of the neutrino and the operators sigma of all three components of the sigma of the neutrinos. And that was a lengthy calculation, amazingly so, and the answer is actually quite complicated. The answer involves the angular momentum operator of this sheet. So I can rotate the sheet. That's an operation, an operator. And that I can call the ontological angular momentum operator. It's just the operator which rotates the sheet. And that operator is needed to define the neutrino x component. And then this is a remainder that you might not expect. These are the spin operators, S3. S3 is just S. But S1 and S2 are spin flip operators. So when you measure the spin, the location of the neutrino x, you actually need the spin flip operators. Something of a surprise, and these are these theta and phi coordinates on the this sphere. So this argument, I'm not explaining why it comes out because this is a lengthy calculation, but it shows, and the outcome is very non-trivial, and I made many mistakes for getting at the right answer. So finally, everything then agrees, and you find this result. So it's mathematically a little bit contrived model. And so you see that the funny thing is you need these coordinates phi and theta on the sheet as well. And you need the spin flip operators, S1 and S2, just to define x. And the same thing for p of the neutrino, and then also the Pauli matrices, sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 3 of the neutrino. All those are related to, but not identical to this spin operator. So it gets interesting. But that then, once you've done all this, you understand how the mapping goes precisely. And you find it's very non-trivial to go from the sheets back to the neutrinos. Now I want to go to my third example. And that is, the third example is superstring theory. And you might be a bit surprised that at this stage, I already mentioned superstrings. Well, I won't do it all the way. I'll just do the superstring in its bulk region. I'll take the superstring, but I won't consider the endpoints of a string because they are a bit problematic. And also the interactions of the superstring are problematic in my argument. I'll leave that out. I'll just consider the basic equations of how a superstring in its bulk region behaves. And I claim there I can do something similar. The outcome of this is so surprising and intriguing that I thought I should mention it here. And the first thing to do is to observe that you can play a trick with integers and real numbers. Yes, I think the ultimate model of nature will not know about real numbers. Well, the neutrino was a real number, the harmonic oscillator was a real number, but eventually I want to have models where real numbers don't play a role. I'm thinking, of course, of black hole physics, where, according to the holographic principle, the number of states a black hole can be in is denumerable, and that includes everything living in the vicinity of the black hole. So somehow, at some stage, you have to do away with real numbers. Well, here is a simple theorem that real numbers can be mapped on pairs of integers. So this is the mapping. I take a model which is based on pairs of integers. I call them capital Q and capital P, where the capital means it's an integer only. So capital Q and capital P are integer numbers only. There's 2n of them because I have a P and a Q, and then the I runs from 1 to n. And I'll map that onto a model which has only n real observables, little q. So little q is a real observable, which has a spectrum running from minus infinity to plus infinity. Little p is just the operator canonically associated to that. So p is ddq, and q is ddp in the usual way we talk about that in quantum mechanics, including the factor I, which I forgot to mention. So, so this is a conventional quantum dynamical object, a location q with its momentum p, and there can be n of those. And now I claim that I can make my dual mapping onto a system like this. And if you have integers, you can think of a deterministic model that processes integers. Think of your own computer. If you run a program like Mathematica on your computer, then it just processes integers all the time. And your computer has bits and bytes, which could be just 0 and 1. Those are also integers. But you can compose other integers out of those, and your computer can add or subtract them or multiply. And that's what you can do at this side. And then you can get a deterministic model at this side. And then you can map that onto a quantum model at the other side. This is a general theme. And the argument for that is, and I have to be brief on this, is that if you have a sequence of integers running from minus infinity to plus infinity, think of a single set of integers, I call them capital Q, and think of the Hilbert space spanned by that. Those are big words. The original classical model doesn't know about Hilbert space. It is just completely classical. It has, only thing it knows about is what the value of that integer is. But now I built a Hilbert space around it, and they introduced these states Q with Dirac brackets around them. Now they span Hilbert space, if you indeed insist on making superpositions later. Superpositions are man-made artifacts in this theory at this level, but they are useful. So I'll consider that, and then I'll consider an operator eta. Eta is between minus 1/2 and 1/2, so it is a fractional number. And I now consider an operator called e to the power eta. Now, I take epsilon instead of e, where epsilon is also the base of a logarithm, but e to the power 2 pi, which is 535. That is just for practical reasons. I didn't want my eta to run between minus pi and pi. I wanted my eta to run between minus 1/2 and 1/2. So I wanted to absorb a 2 pi in that eta. And this is the way I do it. I take epsilon to the power I eta. And epsilon to the power I eta is, by definition, the displacement operator. It adds 1 or removes 1 to the integer. So it goes from the integer to integer plus 1. And that is a unitary operation. I call e to the I eta. If I raise that unitary operation to the power n, I get n steps to the right, or minus n, then I go n step to the left. And so this operator is just defined by being the step operator. The step operator is unitary, therefore it can be written as e to the power something, or epsilon to the power something, which is then purely imaginary. And that something will always lie between 1/2 and minus 1/2 and 1/2. And that is the definition of my operator eta. And you can ask, now suppose if I have these integers, how can I explicitly express my operator eta in terms of these integers? It is very easy. You have to realize that I know all the exponentials. So that means I know all the Fourier coefficients of this matrix. In fact, what I can do is I can take the function eta between minus 1/2 and 1/2 and Fourier decompose it into sines of eta. The sine of eta, of course, is built out of these exponentials. So of the sine of eta, I know explicitly the matrix elements. Or sine n of eta, I know also the matrix elements, just making n steps to the right or n steps to the left. So I take the straight line here. I Fourier decompose that into sines and cosines. The cosines don't contribute, but they could be there. Only the sine functions. And then you find that this operator eta is a sum of exponentials of eta. This is just a Fourier decomposition. And the exponential of eta has a matrix element that sandwiches a state Q with a state Q plus n. And so I know its matrix elements. So now I know the matrix elements of the operator eta itself. And it is, it's minus 1 to the power n, which is the steps, number of steps it takes, so q1 minus q2, and then there's a 1 over n here, so okay, 1 over qn minus q1 minus q2. And then I put here a 1, but I actually subtract the delta function. That is because if q1 equals q2, the Fourier coefficient vanishes. So this matrix element vanishes if q1 equals q2, but this is a pole. So in order to remove the pole, I need this delta. So 1 minus delta means that if q1 equals q2, the number must be 0. And so this is the matrix. And what is peculiar about that is that you can now compute the commutator between eta and q. And you find that commutator is this delta function gives you just the identity. So the commutator is just a commutator of between momenta and positions. But I get this minus 1 to the q1 minus q2, but you have to multiply it with q1 minus q2, so now just this minus 1 survives, and that happens to be the outer product of two states, the state psi bra times state psi ket. So there's one state psi for which this number isn't the canonical commutator, and that I call an edge state. So for the edge state, this thing obeys commutation rules that I don't like. So I have to say I'm going to do this for all states orthogonal to this one end state, edge state. So I remove one state out of my Hilbert space. But that's only one state out of an infinite number, so that doesn't seem too bad. So the commutation rule nearly is I over 2 pi. The 1 over 2 pi comes from this artificial 2 pi here, so don't look at that. So there's one edge state. Now I can take two of these things. So I take one sequence of integers and another sequence of integers. The other sequence of integers I'll put on the circle. So the sequence of integers is equivalent to operators living on a circle. This is just, again, a unitary transformation. Now I take the sequence of integers and I take the eta operator for another sequence of integers and I open up the circle. So I take a pair of scissors, open up the circle, I get a line segment between minus 1/2 and 1/2. Now what I'll do, I'll put that line segment in between all these integers to get the real line. That's taking the product space. So the product space of all the sequence of integers and the line between minus 1/2 and 1/2, the line segment, that together generates exactly the real line. In other words, my operator little q can be split up into its integer part and its fractional part. Its fractional part is the eta operator associated to another sequence of integers. Those are called momentum. And this, so q is a position, p is the momentum, and q plus eta p generates entire sets of real numbers. Q is integers, eta is fractional. So whenever you have an integer, you can also split it up into its integer part, its fractional part, and the converse is also true. If you have an integer and a fractional, I can always add them to get any real number I like. So this is how it goes. And once you know how to compute the operator q out of these two sets of integers, you also know how to compute the operator p. You just take the canonically associated thing of that. So you differentiate that to get the p. Now, the outcome of this is that the p is also a combination of integers and fractions, but not quite the same. So this procedure, which I outlined here, is not quite symmetric under p and q. That is not particularly harmful. You might continue along this line, but it can be done slightly better. And what I've done here is I followed a more advanced mathematical technique to get the p and the q treated symmetrically. And what you can then get is you get the matrix elements between the pairs of integers of the little operator little q and the operator little p. So little q is an integer plus a fraction number. The operator p is an integer plus a fraction number. These integers are, of course, the integers p and q. That's easy. But the fractional, the fractional parts now are no longer between minus 1/2 and 1/2. But there are some tails sticking out a little bit. That is to make them symmetric. But then these operators, little a of q, little a of p, it can be found to be these matrix elements. And that is nice because they look completely symmetric. And furthermore, you can now consider the commutator between p and q. The commutator between p and q is not what you might have expected, because you might have expected, well, by construction, that commutator must be I over 2 pi, 2 pi being, again, a consequence of my use of epsilon. So I over 2 pi. But it isn't that. There's, again, an edge state, and that edge state is minus 1 to the power p plus q. There's only one edge state. I have to remove that from my Hilbert space manually, physically. So there's one state for which it doesn't work. For all the other states, my p and q just obey the usual commutators. So this is the manipulation I want to do. And then I wanted to go to my next step, which is do this in quantum field theory. Think of a quantum field as an integer-valued operator. These integer-valued operators are split into their integer part and a fractional part, and I go through this procedure. Well, you would like to do that, but then you hit upon a major obstacle. The major obstacle is that you have field equations, and those field equations mix the real numbers, but they don't care about the integer part and fractional part. They mix them up. So the sum of two real numbers have an integer part, which is not the sum of the integer parts separately, but there might be a jump of a 1 or a minus 1. And same thing for the fractional parts. The fractional parts might get a remainder that you have to add to the integer part. So it's not that easy. And if you want to work out this thing mathematically, you end up into a mess. And so I gave up. I couldn't do this for quantum field theory. But I could do it in 1 plus 1 dimensions. So take one space and one time dimensions and put temporarily space-time on a very dense lattice. So I have a lattice of space-time that makes my quantum field theory more manageable than all the quantum function integrals become ordinary integrals and so on in a very high dimensions, but still ordinary integrals that I can understand. And so you often do that, you put field theory on a lattice, and then you work out all your commutation rules. But now the evolution law is much simpler. If you have a massless scalar field in 1 plus 1 dimensions, the evolution law is extremely simple. The fields turn out to split up into components which move to the left and components which move to the right. And so I make the splitting right from the beginning. I get things moving to the left, things moving to the right. And for these separately, I split them up into integer parts and fractional parts. Now the evolution law does not involve additions anymore. It just involves displacements. It moves to the right, moves to the left. So at one time step, I move one step on my lattice to the right or one step on my lattice to the left. And there, then, integer part and fractional part continue to be the same. So now I can have the operators capital Q and capital P, or eta of Q and eta of P, to be operators that also shift to the left or shift to the right. And everything goes beautifully. So now for this theory, I can do it. Now for this theory, you then discover that the capitals Q and the capitals P obey equations of this sort. This happens to be the field equation, which becomes so extremely simple because I'm considering non-interacting fields in 1 plus 1 dimensions. And then the field equation becomes as simple as this. And this, again, is an automaton. There's no longer any reference to Hilbert space. These are just classical equations. So now this theory, again, becomes classical. And I don't want to go through all these calculations, actually. You have to go through it if you want to make it more precise. I want to understand what the commutation rules are. In a continuum field theory, I have left movers and right movers as P plus or minus the gradient of phi. Then one part moves to the left, one part moves to the right. And the Hamiltonian is the left moving squared plus the right moving squared. And so on and so forth. So you go through all this algebra. I don't want to bother you about algebra too much. But now if I put space and time on a lattice, then I have these commutators on a lattice by AL and AI. The commutator rule turns out to be such that, of course, at the same spot, they can only commute because AL commutes. But if I look at neighbors, they're non-commuting. So actually, in the continuum, the commutator is the derivative of a delta function, which means that if you go one step to the right, you have a large peak. Once at the left, you have a large peak, but then it's zero again. And on a lattice, it just means that the commutator is I over 2 pi if you make one step to the right or one step to the left. Now, this I can solve in terms of my operators. I just take my A to be an integer plus a fractional part, but the fractional part I displace on one step. Now, if you look carefully, you find immediately that this obeys these commutation rules. Modulo the edge states, which I throw away. So then my field theory is equivalent to this system, and this actually survives the evolution law, so this is how my mapping is going to work. And my time is running out. What the conclusion of this is, oh yes, of course, I should now add, we don't live in 1 plus 1 dimensions, but strings do. The world sheet of a string is a one-space, one-time-dimensional thing. The fields on the world sheet of a string is actually the string coordinates. So the string coordinates are described by having a world sheet of strings, having coordinates on the world sheet, and those coordinates, they move around just like in a 1 plus 1 dimensional field theory on the string world sheet, but they tell you how the string evolves in the real space and time. So the fields are the coordinates, And as I just explained, those coordinates have to be split up into integer part, the fractional part. The fractional part is just displacement operators. What you then get is that this string then lives on a lattice because it only knows what integer values of its coordinates. Integer coordinates, that's by definition a lattice. So this string theory actually turns out to live on a lattice. And the big surprise now comes. I computed the lattice length. What is the sizes of the meshes of this lattice? It turns out that those sizes are independent of how I chose the original lattice on the world sheet. In fact, I can take the continuum limit on the world sheet. And then still, space and time live on a lattice where the lattice size, the lattice mesh length, is always 2 pi times the square root of the alpha prime parameter of the string. Alpha prime tells you what the tension of the string is. It's a very large number, no, very small number in terms of Planck units. It's about the Planck length squared. So square root of alpha prime is the Planck length divided by the string constant. So the weaker the string constant, the larger this alpha prime is. So typically this is, say, 100 times the Planck length or something like that. So we have a lattice, a little bigger than the Planck size, and it doesn't go to zero. And this, of course, explains why string theory is finite. There is no ultraviolet divergence anymore. The theory gives its own cutoff on that lattice. But on this lattice, the string equations become classical. Now, this is the good part of the story. I haven't yet told you the bad part of it. I wanted to do the string interactions and found major complications to arise. The lattice is only lattice in the transverse space of the string variables. The string has two longitudinal coordinates, which is a coordinate in the direction of the string, and it has d minus 2 transverse coordinates if d is the dimensionality of space-time. So if you have string theory in 26 dimensions, two of those are longitudinal, 24 of them are transverse. The transverse coordinates are discrete. The longitudinal ones are not. That has to do with Lorentz invariance. So if you make a Lorentz transformation, the lattice length may shrink or expand due to Lorentz contraction. So that's a delicacy that is not completely under control as yet. But the transverse space is totally classical and totally on the lattice. And so it's deterministic. So the bulk theory, this is my conclusion, the bulk theory of string theory is deterministic. My time's running out, I think. I want to do the same thing about fermions, that fermions turn string theory into a superstring. But for the fermions, you can do exactly the same thing. Fermions are pluses and minuses, are not integers, but Boolean variables, plus and minus. Apart from that, fermions go the same way. And of course, I wanted to discuss Bell's inequalities, because that's what everybody is now concerned about. But you had already so much talk about that yesterday that I'm not going to repeat my arguments about Bell's inequalities. So what I like is make models, have them make mathematically consistent all themselves, and the bottom line is, of course, shut up and calculate. And shut up and calculate, I mean with that, take a model and calculate and see how it works, and then worry about Bell's inequalities. But I should stop. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the presentation. We have a short time for questions or remarks. Theo.
Your neutrinos were infinitely large. You had these infinite sheets, but then also they had zero mass. So what do you expect if they have a finite mass? Would then this size be finite, for instance, be the Compton length?
I wish that were true, but things become much more complicated. If you give them finite mass, you can think of mass as being a fifth dimension. So then these sheets are rotated in a fifth dimension, and that means that if the dimension is compactified, that's the mass, then the sheet contains. So a massive neutrino is not one sheet, but a whole sequence of sheets, being basically one Compton wavelength away apart from each other. So a massive neutrino is a whole stack of sheets, with sheet distance 1 over the mass. So the bigger the mass, the smaller the mass, the further away those sheets are. And that gets pretty ugly to my mind, so that's why I didn't talk about it.
You don't want to resum your sheets then?
Pardon?
You don't want to resum your sheets, get some simpler representation.
Well, you can dream about trying to do such things, but I ran into difficulties, so I said for a moment, my neutrino stayed massless.
Yes, I'm the
mathematical representation. And I think you never mentioned that there exists so-called Koopman von Neumann formalism. It's possible to represent classical phase space mechanics as in complex Hilbert space. So I think it's very supporting for your theory.
This is exactly the philosophy I'm adhering to.
Yeah, but I just tell that such formalism also exists from very beginning, and people know
course,
that.
Of course, this is how quantum mechanics started in the first place. People wouldn't immediately accept Hilbert space. They would just say that there are classical things, and Hilbert space is just a way to do the mathematics. It's just say well, let's consider those states and let's manipulate them. Mathematically, I can always consider superpositions. Doesn't mean anything physically, it just means probabilistic distribution of some sort. But so that's how then I continue. But of course, this is how people originally thought about quantum mechanics. But then all these arguments about hidden variables being impossible just make people close their eyes towards this very basic way of looking at quantum mechanics.
That just means that it was stream other way around, such classical statistical mechanics. Can be represented as quantum mechanics in very the same way, so not operators and
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
I like the whole presentation. I wish you have more time to show us some of the other slides. One issue is entanglement. Do you have some slides there prepared to explain that?
Which not you've... really very much. I had the slides about the Bell inequalities. Of course, Bell is about entangled particles. And I don't see any basic problem with entanglement because I allow all states in this Hilbert space, including, of course, entangled states. So by itself, having entangled particles is no mystery. The mystery, of course, is in the Bell inequalities and the violation of those. But actually, the difficulty I have goes much further than entangled particles. Even non-entangled particles are a fundamental problem. And this is the problem, well, I think, I don't know if it was mentioned yesterday, but suppose that someone does experiments and measures a proton coming from a quasar, a photon coming from a quasar, and you measure the polarization of the photon. So you have it go through a polarization filter, and you ask, does a photon go through or not? If the photon goes through, its polarization is this way. If the photon does not go through, the polarization is this way. So the photon knows, the photon comes out with a definite polarization. And that's the ontological state. Then my theory would say then that the photon always had that polarization all the way from the quasar onwards. So at the quasar, the photon was produced by one of its billions of stars, and it had this particular polarization. It will continue to have the polarization until it goes through the polarizer I'm using now to measure that photon. But the strange thing is the photon knew that billions of years in advance. It had to be polarized that way. That is its ontological state. This is very mysterious, but that's eventually also your problem with Bell's inequality. It's the same problem, but now I have two such photons rather than one. And the fact that they are entangled is not so much of my concern, but the fact that they are polarized, which is much more basic, is already a difficulty.
So simply, can you translate the equivalent description by classical mechanics? Quantum entanglement.
I should have added, maybe this is the one transparency I just made up a few seconds ago, but now I forgot your question. These were the things I wanted to add about the basic arguments of entanglement. What I'm saying here, among other things, that the theory we're looking for will be a very strange theory, I think very unconventional. Because I believe that most theories people have come up with now are too close to our experience, that we think this is the world, the way the world is built. In reality, the world is built in a very different way. So I think probably the model we are looking for is something to be very outlandish, very unconventional, because it will have to deal with all the problems that we are facing today and we are discussing today, and ordinary models usually don't do it right. So, of course, I'm looking for a model where all these things come out correctly, automatically. And that includes, of course, description of entangled particles and everything else. But my problem goes before you even discuss entangled particles, non-entangled particles are also a problem.
I look forward to that. Thank you.